Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
According to unofficial results, the Fatah movement is ahead of the Islamic resistance movement, Hamas, in the Palestinian municipality elections. There was a high voter turnout, 70% in the West Bank and 80% in the Gaza Strip. According to the Palestinian Election Committee, Fatah has received 59.5% of the votes, while Hamas received 33.3%. A Hamas spokesman forewarned rushing to conclusions about unofficial election results.
على عكس نتائج الجولة الأولى منها تقدمت حركة فتح على منافستها الرئيسية حماس.
In contrast to the first round of the elections, today Fatah is leading the race against its chief rival Hamas in the second round of the Palestinian municipal elections. Initial results indicate that Fatah received 57% of the votes, while Hamas received 34%, and the rest of the Palestinian factions received 9%. This may be attributed to the fact that these preliminary results are reported from the West Bank, where Hamas does not enjoy as much support as in the Gaza Strip, where they ran in 8 out of the 84 districts. The other reason is that Fatah was well organized in the aftermath of its loss in the first round of elections, and it took a united position to avoid dividing the votes this time.
I believe that Fatah ran a united campaign in every district, thus it was victorious, and in the districts where it seemed to be hesitant, it did not achieve the expected results. I think that the secret behind the success of the Fatah movement is its ability to rely on an internal vision for the democratic process, which will ultimately lead to electing city or legislative officials.
غير أن حركة حماس التي تقول إنها لم تشارك سوى في أربعة.
The Hamas movement said that it only ran in 74 out of 84 electoral districts. It urged not to rush to conclusions about the results and accused Fatah of committing violations that affected the election process and results.
حركات كثيرة. وما معنى أن تكون الأجهزة الأمنية في داخل مراكز الاقتراع؟
There are many violations. What does it mean to have the members of the security agency inside the polling centers? What does it mean when the employees of several ministries threaten people, saying that if they vote for the Hamas list, they will stop receiving aid and other assistance? What does it mean when hundreds of bags of flour and food are distributed to a number of locations? What does it mean to give out money?
Despite this controversy, international monitors overseeing the election process commended this democratic development, even though some questionable incidents had occurred.
Generally, we can say that this election reflects a strong desire for democracy.
وبغض النظر عن تقدم فتح أو حماس في هذه الانتخابات إلا أن بعض
Regardless of Hamas or Fatah leading in this election, some factions try to establish themselves in the political front, but the Palestinian initiative is still in its infancy. More importantly is the race to acquire parliamentary seats, which is expected to be fierce. Everyone is preparing for the parliamentary elections, and perhaps these municipal elections are an indication of what lies ahead. Majid Saeed, Abu Dhabi Television, Ramallah.
In other elections, Britain's Prime Minister Tony Blair survived opposition over the Iraq War to win a historic third straight term in power, but saw his authority weakened by a drastically reduced majority in Parliament. Blair won his place in British history, becoming only the second Premier after Margaret Thatcher to win three elections in a row. With most results in, Blair was heading for a majority of between 60 and 80 seats in the 646-seat House of Commons, sharply down from 161 last time. Blair's reduced majority could now hinder his legislative program and hasten a handover to his powerful finance minister and assumed heir Gordon Brown. A hard core between 30 to 40 Labour members of parliament have voted consistently against Blair in the last 2 years.
I know that Iraq has been a deeply divisive issue in this country. That's been very, very clear. But I also know and believe that after this election, people want to move on. They want to focus on the future in Iraq and here. And I know too that there are many other issues that concern people in the international agenda, and we will focus on those, on poverty in Africa, on climate change, on making progress in Israel and Palestine.
Syria has said it regrets the new U.S. decision to extend economic sanctions imposed on the country since May last year. Syrian Minister of Information Mahdi Dakhlallah criticized the U.S. policy in the Middle East, which he said only favors the Israeli interests. He added that although the decision had been expected, it is regrettable. U.S. President George W. Bush extended yesterday the economic sanctions on Syria, saying the Arab country remained a threat to the United States. Bush also extended a ban on certain U.S. exports to Syria and other sanctions that were imposed on May 11, 2004. In originally imposing the sanctions, Bush accused Syria of supporting terrorism, continuing its occupation of Lebanon, pursuing weapons of mass destruction, and undermining efforts to stabilize Iraq.
في مصر لقي عضو بجماعة الإخوان المسلمين يدعى طارق الغنام.
In Egypt, a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, Tariq al-Ghannam, was killed after security forces launched tear gas in order to disperse a demonstration organized by the Muslim Brotherhood in Mansoura City, north of Cairo. There were massive demonstrations in Cairo and in a number of Egyptian cities organized by the Muslim Brotherhood, protesting the continuing emergency law and the lack of taking any real reforms by the government. The demonstrators demanded that President Mubarak not run for a fifth presidential term while the security forces surrounded worshippers inside a mosque in the New Egypt neighborhood and arrested dozens of demonstrators. This came only hours after the Egyptian security authorities arrested Dr. Isam Al-Aryan, a prominent leader of the Muslim Brotherhood, this morning. The authorities are investigating him. The Egyptian authorities also arrested three other leaders. With us live from Cairo, our correspondent Hani Amara. Hani, first, do you have information about the four leaders of the Brotherhood who were arrested, including the prominent leader Isam Al-Aryan?
نعم. يعني ما حدث اليوم هو أن الدكتور عصام العريان كان في منزله.
Yes. What happened today? Dr. Isam Al-Aryan was in his home with three others. And they were all arrested under the pretext that they were meeting to organize protests in more than one place today. So the actions taken by the authorities have created an unwanted escalation of the situation.
نعم. وكالة الأنباء الخصوصة الفرنسية تحدثت عن اعتقال أكثر من 1000.
The Agence France Press reported that 1600 Muslim Brotherhood supporters have been arrested and that one of them has been killed. Are we seeing the beginning of real confrontations between the Muslim Brotherhood and the Egyptian government?
دعنا اولا نلحظ التقديرات هناك تفاوت في التقديرات.
First, let me say something about the numbers. The number of people that were arrested according to the Muslim Brotherhood differs from that according to the government. The Muslim Brotherhood says that more than 2,000 people were detained, but official sources say that only 400 were detained, including the 70 that were arrested today. As far as the person who was killed today, yes, we can regard this as an escalation. Everything happening now comes within the framework of political maneuvers between the Egyptian authorities and the banned Muslim Brotherhood organization. Today, we witness this magnitude and intensity of demonstrations for the third time in less than 1 month. Thus, we can say that the Muslim Brotherhood is escalating the situation and increasingly defying the authorities. It appears that the Muslim Brotherhood is no longer working behind the scenes. Rather, it is willing to openly confront authorities. The two factors that have contributed to this phenomenon are the presidential and the parliamentary elections, which are both approaching. Although the Muslim Brotherhood is not trying to influence the presidential elections, it wants to influence the parliamentary elections. The Brotherhood wants to obtain a large political base and achieve political gains. It is using the presidential elections to pressure the Egyptian authorities. Let us establish one thing. The Egyptian authorities find themselves on the defensive, not only because of the pressure exerted on them by the Muslim Brotherhood, but also by the opposition in general. The opposition parties see this as a golden opportunity to pressure the government so they can obtain more political ground.
Hello and welcome. Maronite Patriarch Cardinal Nasrallah Boutrous-Fehr called for friendly and honest ties among the Lebanese and for Lebanon and Syria to establish diplomatic representation and demarcate their borders. He was speaking at a meeting that focused on parliamentary elections with Cornet Chihuahua opposition members. MP Boutrous-Harib denied reports of defections among the group's ranks and said they are all committed to the small voting district of Qada in parliamentary elections. He told reporters in Kirki, Cornet Chihuahua opposes any proposal that does not treat all Lebanese and regions equally ahead of elections. He accused remnants of the military regime, in his words, of spreading rumors about the group's division and lashed out at whom he described as the figure that is now championing Christian interests but had itself authored the controversial 2000 electoral law in a clear reference to President Emil Ahoud. He also urged the family of assassinated Prime Minister Rashid Karami to support the release of imprisoned opposition leader Samir Jaja. Habib Attah has a story.
Members of the Christian Cornet Chihuahuan opposition front, which includes MPs and political figures, visited Kirke, the seat of the Maronite Church, for talks with Patriarch Cardinal Nasrallah Boutrous-Fehr that focused on upcoming elections and the controversy surrounding the electoral law that will govern the crucial polls. Sfehr welcomed Syria's pullout from Lebanon as historic, but voiced concern at the continued detention and exile of some Lebanese. He said the Lebanese citizens should open a new page in friendly and honest ties among each other with Syria. Sfehr stressed that if every party wanted to take over all parliamentary seats in upcoming ballots, without agreement to divide seats among opposition factions, there would be, quote, losses and disappointment among Christian ranks. The patriarch also cited UN demands for launching diplomatic ties between Lebanon and Syria and to clearly demarcate the borders of both countries. Talks in Kirke come a day before parliament meets under intense pressure from the opposition bid to seek a compromise on the controversial electoral law 22 days ahead of the much-awaited legislative polls. The meeting will coincide with the return of Christian hardliner Michel Aoun, a staunch opponent of the 2000 law tailored by Syria, which had forced him into exile in France 15 years ago. Pro-Syrian parliamentary speaker Nabih Berri issued a terse statement just before midnight Thursday, saying parliament would meet Saturday morning after President Emil Lahoud signed a decree to hold elections later this month. In a series of meetings with opposition leaders, including Christian MPs and Druze leader Walid Jumblatt, the speaker said he was opposed to any attempts to throw out the 2000 electoral law. But he told Jumblatt he would agree to a slight amendment to please the opposition, which is demanding greater representation in the elections based on the Qada, or smaller constituency, rather than the larger Muhafaza. Lahoud, who is a Christian but in pro-Syrian camp, warned in a letter to Parliament this week that holding elections based on the 2000 text could lead the country into a period of political instability. Christian MPs in the opposition have also made it clear that elections based on the larger Muhafaza plan would deal a blow to democracy in Lebanon and play into the hands of the pro-Syrian loyalists. Lebanon has been under intense pressure from the international community to hold free and credible elections since the February 14th assassination of former Prime Minister Rafiq Hariri. His death in an explosion that killed 19 others prompted unprecedented demonstrations across the country, which has been mired in confessional and political discord since the harrowing days of the 1975-1990 civil war. UN envoy Terry Rod Larson and both the French and US ambassadors to Lebanon, Bernard Emier and Jeffrey Feltman, have kept up the pressure over the past 48 hours by contacting political and religious figures across the country.
As Habib Attah mentioned, President Lahoud had issued a decree confirming elections would start on time on May 29th, but under voting laws opposed by the opposition. Still, the window for changing the law appears to be open.
Lahoud's approval of the 2000 electoral law is expected to usher in one of the most anticipated elections in Lebanon's history, in line with the timetable demanded by the international community. But earlier, Lahoud had urged Parliament to change the rules governing the ballot, especially over constituencies, which are seen to favor Syria's allies, to the dismay of Christian opposition figures. Faced with a midnight deadline, Lahoud, however, signed a decree that stipulates the elections be held according to the controversial rules adopted in 2000 in the midst of Syria's tight grip over the country, after the Speaker, Nabih Berri, failed to convene Parliament to debate a new electoral law. The date of the elections agreed by the government last week would have been thrown in doubt had Lahoud not issued the decree on Thursday. Lahoud's decree appeared to crush efforts by the opposition to hold an 11th-hour parliamentary session to adopt a new law that would give the minority Christians greater representation. But opposition figures continued to push the matter at a meeting between Christian MPs and pro-Syrian Parliament Speaker Nabih Birri. MP Nailam Awad told AFP after the meeting that Birri had made certain offers but, quote, no results were reached. Fellow Deputy Faris Saeed said the opposition would not relinquish its demands to hold elections based on the Qaeda or smaller constituencies to bolster the Christians and other minorities. He said the group asked Birri to put to a vote on Saturday a law based on the Qaeda, but said Birri refused, asking for a compromise, which was declined. The 2000 law, which was in effect during Lebanon's last legislative elections, carves up Lebanon into 14 electoral constituencies. Lahoud, in a letter to Parliament, said the 2000 law, which split Lebanon in a way seen to favor Damascus' allies, was causing a sharp political dispute that could lead to unbalanced representation. Lahoud is a longtime Syrian ally, but he appears to be seeking favor among his own Maronite Christian community in their opposition to the election law. An official source told AFP that Parliament could still intervene and revise the terms of the law, short of replacing it, in a way to satisfy the opposition. Voting in Beirut will be held on May 29th, southern Lebanon on June 5th, Mount Lebanon and eastern Bekaa Valley on June 12th, and northern Lebanon on June 19th. The tug of war in Lebanon came as United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan ordered the head of UN Electoral Assistance Division, Karina Pirelli, to head to Beirut to prepare for the polls. Pirelli is due Friday in Beirut along with an assistant for a two-week stay. The 15-nation UN Security Council issued a unanimous statement on Wednesday urging Lebanon to hold polls on time and seek international help to ensure that they are free and credible. In Brussels, the European Commission announced that a 90-strong observer team would be sent to Lebanon next Tuesday for the elections led by Spanish Conservative Euro MP Ignacio Salafranca Sanchez Nieira. The Commission said it welcomed the prospect of holding genuinely democratic parliamentary elections, which are a means to reaffirm full sovereignty.
Progressive Socialist Party leader MP Walid Jumblat warned against amending the Taif peace accord that ended Lebanon's civil war. After talks with Speaker Birri and son of slain Premier Rafiq al-Hariri, Saad al-Din al-Hariri, the opposition leader said amending the accord would be very dangerous. The Taif had redistributed executive powers among Lebanon's 17 sects. Before the war, Muslims accused Maronites of having too much power at their expense. Jumblat also said a major sect should not be isolated, in an apparent reference to Shiites, after the title changes that followed late Premier Hariri's assassination. He denied turning his back on the Christians, saying he was committed to small voting districts and rejected the 2000 law, which he said President Lahoud had offered. He said Lahoud, who had been an international outcast after Syria forced an extension to his mandate, was now acting as a champion of Christian interests. Exiled former army commander and opposition leader General Michel Aoun is preparing to return home on Saturday. Some 170 of his supporters returned overnight. The court earlier suspended an arrest warrant for the former general, paving the way for his return this week from 15 years of exile. The arrest warrant against Aoun was issued in 2003 after he testified before the U.S. Congress and called on it to pass a law imposing sanctions on Syria. Another court had a day earlier dropped charges against Aoun issued in 1990, which accused him of assaulting state security, national unity and the constitution, and embezzling state funds. Members of his Free Patriotic Movement will contest the parliamentary elections. Many Maronites say the arrest of Samir Jaja, the Christian former warlord and the exile of Aoun, who has strong support among Christians, symbolized the targeting of their community by the Syrian-dominated order after the war. Jaja is serving multiple life sentences for political assassinations during the war. Former Premier Omar Karami will receive today a delegation of MPs who are lobbying for Jaja's release. If Karami dropped charges against Jaja for alleged assassination of his brother, Parliament could on Saturday vote to grant him amnesty. Prime Minister Najib Mikati is en route to New York for talks with UN Secretary General Kofi Annan on the implementation of Security Council Resolution 1559 before heading to Brazil for a summit of Arab and Latin American leaders. A team of United Nations inspectors had visited a Syrian army position, which some say is in Lebanon, but declined to comment on the area's unclear demarcation. The team expects its mission to last more than a week and will report back to Kofi Annan. More with Habib Attah.
Brigadier General Alhaji Mamadou Kanji, Deputy Military Advisor for UN Peacekeeping Operations, said discussions with Syrian officers were warm. The Senegalese officer is heading a three-man UN team in Lebanon to verify a Syrian troop withdrawal, which Damascus said it complete on April 26th. Prime Minister Najib Mikati told French newspaper Le Monde on Monday that Syrian troops were still deployed in Deir al-Asher and that the location was inside Lebanese territory. But the following day, Mikati's office issued a statement saying that the preliminary investigation showed that the soldiers were deployed on Syrian, not Lebanese land. Residents of Deir al-Asher said this week they believe the Syrian soldiers were deployed on Lebanese land, but agreed that the border in the area was poorly demarcated. Kenji told reporters Wednesday he was satisfied with the mission so far. The UN team has verified dozens of former Syrian military positions in northern Lebanon, Tripoli, Beirut, and around the eastern Bekaa Valley. The UN Security Council acknowledged Syria's statements that its forces had withdrawn, but it said there had been no progress in other provisions of its Resolution 1559, adopted last September, that called for the disarmament of a militia so the Lebanese government could control all of its territory. The Council's statement did not mention warning shots fired several hours earlier on the UN verification team surveying abandoned Syrian bases in the Bekaa Valley. Shots were fired when the team drove toward a post for the Syrian-backed Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine General Command, which refused to let them in.
Aides close to Saudi Arabia's Crown Prince Abdullah bin Abdulaziz said he will use his upcoming visit to Syria to ask President Bashar al-Assad not to meddle in Lebanon, following recent talks in the U.S. where he urged President George W. Bush to ease pressure on Damascus. Abdullah is also due to meet with Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak. Speaking on condition of anonymity, aides said Saudi Arabia wants Syrian cooperation with the United Nations Security Council probe into the murder of former Prime Minister Rafiq al-Hariri. Saudi sources said Bush and Abdullah had agreed that Assad should be given a chance to introduce political and security reforms at home and to formulate a policy of non-intervention in Lebanon, especially by Syrian security services. President Bush urged the international community to assist Lebanon's new democracy that will emerge after Syria's full withdrawal, the end of Syria's interference, and following legislative elections. He said it will serve as a model for the entire region. Bush said Syria's pullout will bring about a vacuum in Lebanon, but the international community should help the new government that will be formed after elections to guarantee the rights of minorities. Earlier, Bush extended economic sanctions on Syria imposed last year and said it supported terrorism and was undermining efforts to stabilize Iraq. He accused Syria of supporting terrorism, pursuing weapons of mass destruction, undermining efforts to stabilize Iraq, and, quote, continuing its occupation of Lebanon, and said this posed a continuing, unusual and extraordinary threat to the U.S.
His Excellency Abdurrahman bin Hamad Al Attiyah, Secretary General of the Gulf Cooperation Council countries, hailed His Majesty Sultan Qaboos' current visit to His Highness Sheikh Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, Emir of Qatar. His Excellency the GCC Secretary in General said in a statement to the Oman News Agency that this visit comes in culmination of the historical ties and the ongoing relations of contacts and consultation between the two countries' leaderships. His Excellency highly appraised the distinguished efforts exerted by the Joint Omani-Qatari Committee for enhancing the bilateral relations, which played a fundamental role in activating the cooperation stages between the two countries and pushing them forward, in addition to its contribution to supporting the joint GCC march towards the targeted integration. The latest in a series of Palestinian made rockets landed in the southern Israeli town of Sderot early today, sparking protests from local residents but causing no casualties. Military sources said two of the projectiles fired from the nearby Gaza Strip and called Qassam rockets had landed in the same town last night. Military sources said that residents held protest early today after the latest firing. The incidents have come despite a pledge by the main Palestinian resistance groups in March to respect a period of calm until the end of the year on condition that Israel halts its attacks. The rockets are manufactured by the armed wing of the Hamas group. A market bombing in Suwayrah, southeast of Baghdad, killed at least 16 people and wounded up to 50. In another blast, 12 people were killed and 3 wounded today near Tikrit when a suicide car bomber rammed a minibus. 8 policemen and 4 civilians, including a child, were killed in the attack. The explosion took place at around 8 a.m. near an army and police checkpoint on a road leading north out of Tikrit, a city about 180 kilometers north of Baghdad. Elsewhere, 4 Iraqi commandos were killed and 5 wounded yesterday when a suicide bomber detonated a car laden with explosives next to a patrol in the northern city of Mosul. The commandos were members of the Interior Ministry's Crack Lightning Brigade. 3 of the 5 wounded were seriously hurt. Meanwhile, the bodies of at least 12 people who had been shot and killed were found buried at a garbage dump in Baghdad today. Iraqi officials said some of the victims were blindfolded and had been shot in the head execution style. Iranian Foreign Minister Kamal Karzai said his country wanted to continue talks with the European Union on Tehran's nuclear program if there was a good chance of resolving the standoff. Karzai's comments came after a meeting with United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan on the sidelines of a UN-sponsored conference on nuclear disarmament. Sharing Washington's suspicion that Iran is developing atomic weapons, the EU has offered economic and political incentives if Tehran scraps its enrichment program.
On nuclear issue, I said that our program is quite peaceful. It's under the supervision of IAEA as the watchdog. But we are determined to continue with our illegal activities, which is only for producing fuel needed for our power plants. But in the same time, we will continue our negotiations with the European side, provided it would lead us to somewhere tangible in a matter of time framework.
In the United Arab Emirates, the wedding of all weddings, a communal marriage ceremony for 200 young men and women, was organized. The ceremony coincided with the marriage of the Minister of Presidential Affairs, His Royal Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan. He funded the collective wedding ceremony, and the UAE Marriage Fund planned the ceremony. The United Arab Emirates is celebrating a national day, helping to start about 100 new families in the UAE. There were 100 grooms at the ceremony, which was called the Wedding of All Weddings. It was filled with happiness and joyful crowd celebrating this sacred event. The Minister of Presidential Affairs, His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan, attended the ceremony. This wedding ceremony is a unique yet traditional cultural event. It is a beautiful foundation for social welfare, aiming to strengthen the ties within the society and instilling the traditions and values of the country in the new generation. The Wedding of All Weddings is a beautiful event. Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan wanted to follow in the footsteps of the late Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, who led the way in social, charitable, and humanitarian work. The late Sheikh started the Marriage Fund, responsible for providing marriage assistance to young UAE citizens, helping them start strong, united, and stable families.
Congratulations. I send my gratitude and greetings to His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed for this beautiful gesture and for his luminous attendance this evening. He brought happiness, love, and joy to the hearts of many young couples and their families.
A number of poets read poetry in celebration of this occasion. It was celebrated in the traditional way, consisting of 5 programs displaying the old wedding traditions and the bridal wear. There was an immediate response and positive reaction to this event. It also generated support from businessmen and the private sector, sponsoring the wedding of several couples and generously contributing to the UAE Marriage Fund, which is one of the national funds in need of assistance and contributions.
May God bless Abu Zayed. He sponsored this collective wedding ceremony. May God bless his marriage and everyone else's, our brothers who are getting married and everyone already married.
His Highness greeted the grooms who lined up at the entrance to the site, congratulating and blessing them on this happy occasion. He also took pictures with the newlyweds. Congratulations to everyone and best wishes for a happy and wonderful family life.
The views expressed on Mosaic are not those of Link TV or its sponsors, but of the broadcasters themselves. Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, which promotes journalism excellence worldwide and invests in the vitality of 26 U.S. communities, and the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, Additional support is provided by the Fire Doll Foundation and Henry and Virgilia Dakin.